Good morning. Welcome back to Morning Express from Matters Business. It is Tuesday, so we do focus on your health as well today. And we are talking all about the esophagus cancer. And before I introduce you to my guests, imagine not being able to eat or even swallow anything when cancer of the esophagus sets in. According to the Ministry of Health guidelines for cancer management, esophagus cancer ranks among the top three cancer killers in the country. But it can be prevented and it can be cured. But first, we need to debunk the many myths around it.
Cancer of the esophagus is rapidly becoming one of the most common cancers in Kenya. This abnormal growth affects the esophagus, the long tube that carries food or drink from the throat to the stomach for digestion. The top part of the esophagus lies behind the windpipe. The bottom part runs down through the chest between the spine and the heart. We spoke to Dr. Lucy Mushiri, a pathologist and associate professor at the University of Nairobi, and Dr. Aurora Maranga, an oncologist, to understand this cancer more.
It blocks the tube, then you can't swallow. So you basically, you can't eat, you can't feed.
We set out to find out how much do Kenyans know about this cancer, what are the myths that they believe in, and what facts do they need to know.
You haven't heard much about esophagus cancer. I would like to hear more about it.
Taking very hot things could probably interfere with your system, or alcoholism.
Myth one, esophageal cancer is rare.
Know that cancer of the esophagus is one of the top 10 cancers in this country.
Myth two, men and women have the equal risk.
Slightly more common in men, because obviously in women, the breast and the cervix are the top most common.
Myth three, I can tell the signs very early.
In the very early stages, there are no symptoms and no signs. But there are, of course, preconditions that red flag the risk for cancer of the esophagus. For example, people who have heartburn, it can be detected early. There are ways of screening.
Myth four, everyone is at the same risk. No. Obesity, family history, taking hot liquids, smoking, and excessive alcohol consumption put one at risk. Toxins that aggravate inflammation in the esophagus are also risk factor culprits. Living in communities where the disease is common, it also increases the risk. Myth 5. One size fits all when it comes to treatment.
Treatment has to be tailored to each particular person. The reason being, not every patient comes at the same stage of disease. The main modalities of treatment for esophagus, cancer of the esophagus, is radiotherapy and surgery.
Most people think when they have cancer, it's something that will just kill them immediately.
There's this attitude which we have, which we generally call fatalistic attitude, whereby if I'm diagnosed with cancer today, I'm probably dying the next day. So that is something which we need to address.
With treatment, many people can be cured or live a life of dignity.
Myth 7, I cannot do anything to prevent it.
I think lifestyle change, eat healthy, stop smoking, drink moderately. Some social drinking is acceptable, but alcohol abuse is certainly a risk factor. Eat fresh fruit and vegetables. The desire is to get people come in when they are stage one disease. Then that way you can effect cure, and 5-year survival rate is fairly good.
What do we need to do as a country?
We need to create awareness. I think a lot of people sit at home or in the villages because they don't know that because I'm having this heartburn, I'm having pain when I swallow, maybe I have an ulcer, which is an early warning sign for cancer of the esophagus. Then I can go for treatment early. I don't sit and wait until I can barely swallow. I've lost so much weight.
Success which we get cancer fight against cancer are dismal compared to malaria, to HIV, and to tuberculosis. I think we need to get serious on that.
Dorcas Wangira, KTN.
And that feature by Dorcas setting the stage for our discussion this morning on your health, as she told us a little bit there about cancer of the esophagus. Joining me in studio on my immediate left is Dr. Catherine Nyongesa, who's an oncologist at the Texas Cancer Center, Hallingham. In the middle, Dr. Mudoni Karimi, a pathologist at Lancet. And we have John Peterson Colander, who's a survivor of the cancer of the esophagus. Thank you all for joining us, and good morning to you. So, Dr. Nyongesa, I understand you treated John. So first, perhaps tell us that feature. Do you agree with what was said in there?
Mm-hmm. 100%.
Yeah, 100%. Mm-hmm. Dr. Kirimi, you're more involved with catching it, those signs and symptoms. What is it, perhaps, that was left out from that story? Or what can you re-emphasize for us?
I would like to re-emphasize that, as my colleague Dr. Mushiri pointed out, at very early stages, there is no definitive symptoms and signs. However, in a few patients, constant persistent heartburn is usually ignored. We have patients going on to keep self-medicating over-the-counter anti-heartburn drugs. Well, this might actually be one of the earliest symptoms. And we keep encouraging people, if you keep having persistent heartburn, do not continue just taking over-the-counter drugs. Have it looked at. Mm-hmm. Another common symptom would be difficulty in swallowing. By difficulty in swallowing, I mean initially someone finds it very difficult to swallow solid foods. It feels like the food is getting stuck in the throat.
Right.
Eventually, they find themselves not being able to swallow solids, and they can only swallow liquids. Now, that is a very important symptom that should never be ignored. Mm. If you ever feel like food is actually just getting stuck, you just can't push it down the throat, that is something that should never be ignored. It is a very important symptom.
Okay.
Other than that, persistent vomiting, and especially vomiting of fresh blood. And this may not only just be vomiting of fresh blood. Sometimes that blood may be swallowed. Mm-hmm. And you find this person passing stool that is dark colored. Because this blood has been swallowed, it's been digested in the stomach, it's undergone all the process of digestion with the acids, it's gone through the whole gastrointestinal tract. So by the time it's being passed out as stool, the stool is actually dark colored. That is something else that should not be ignored. If one finds that their stool has suddenly become, like black, another very important symptom.
Okay. Let me come to you, Peterson, to talk to us about what for you was the concern before you went to seek a medical attention or help. What was it that concerned you?
I had the food stuck in the throat. Mm-hmm. This when I began knowing that I'm sick.
Okay.
I didn't know what type of the sickness. I had to go to a doctor who and to use some machines, and then he told me that the results were that there is a tumor in the throat, and it was cancer.
So you would eat and the food would not go down?
Yeah.
For how long had that been going on for?
1 month, because I thought it was there was no pain.
Okay.
So I thought the food was hard. I was trying the soft food, so I just stayed there for. I started doing all that for 1 month.
Okay.
Before I concluded that I was sick.
All right. And so he came to you, Dr. Nyongesa. So, and that's what he pretty much explained, over 1 month at least trying to eat, the food not going down.
Yeah, so generally they'll present to the surgeon. So he went to the surgeon who did an endoscopy, put a tube through his throat, down into the esophagus or the gullet, and then checked and found there was a growth inside there. Then he took a biopsy, and this biopsy is a small tissue of a small piece of tissue that was now taken to Dr. Kirimi to analyze under a microscope, and it confirmed that indeed it was cancerous.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it came to you, Dr. Kirimi.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So what is the test that you conduct then? indicate that it is a cancer of esophagus. What then do you advise at the point of now catching it? What really is the next step of action?
So as Dr. Nyongesa has explained, when an endoscopy is done, this is a flexible tube is put down, the, you know, the patient gets to swallow a flexible tube with a small camera, and as it's going down, the doctor is observing on a monitor, sort of like a TV screen. And when they see where this growth is, they take a small piece of tissue. Now it is that small piece of tissue from that growth that is then brought to me, the pathologist, who then looks at it under the microscope. Now what I'm looking under the microscope first is to confirm, is it really cancer? And if it is cancer, there are very many different types of cancers of the esophagus, the most common being what we call the squamous cell carcinoma, followed by the adenocarcinoma. But there are many others. So my looking at it under the microscope is to actually figure out which of the many cancers it is, because each one of them has a different type of treatment. Mm-hmm. So like for his case, being squamous cell carcinoma, the treatment options would probably vary from if it was a different kind of cancer. So the test, which is just called histopathology evaluation, is first to confirm, is it really cancer? Because not all growths are cancerous. Mm-hmm. So the first thing is to confirm, is it cancer? And if it is cancer, which of the many cancers of the esophagus is it? So that then my colleague, Dr. Nyongesa, the oncologist, knows how to treat that particular cancer.
Okay. So it was broken down for you which cancer it was. Yes. What is the treatment that you took him through?
So we first had to reevaluate him clinically and then do some tests to check the stage. And this included an X-ray. It's called a barium swallow. He's given some liquid to swallow to check which part of the esophagus. Is it the upper part? Is it the middle part? Is it the lower part? Because treatment varies depending on the site of the tumor. And also we had to check if it has spread to other organs like the liver, the lungs, and even the lymph nodes. So he had to go through a CT scan, some imaging to determination. Then after we had concluded the stage, he was very lucky because his was not, it hadn't spread to other parts of the body. So we advised him to undergo surgery first. Then after surgery, then we now followed with the radiotherapy and chemotherapy.
All right. Mm-hmm. So Peterson, this happening, being told it's a cancer, but luckily that it hasn't spread to other parts of your body. What was going through your mind at this time? Were you worried?
You know, professionally, I'm a teacher.
Okay.
And teachers counsel other people.
Yes.
With me, I was even beyond a counselor. So when he said the counselors to tell me, don't get worried, I was beyond that. It was not wasting time. I was telling them, go ahead. But with me, I'm okay. With a doctor, I'm convinced that things will be okay. I will cure. And I believe I will cure. So I had no worries. And I was to adhere to the doctor's advice.
Yeah. So you went through the surgery.
Yes.
After the surgery, then the other, you mentioned other treatments.
And then like radiotherapy.
Radiotherapy.
And then finally, you know, his cancer has come back like twice.
Oh, it came, after the surgery it came back.
Yeah, it came back.
So it wasn't completely removed.
It was completely removed, but it has a chance that it can come back.
Okay.
So after surgery, we did radiotherapy, the external treatment, and then when it came back, we had to do more radiotherapy, and this is called brachytherapy. It's a new form of cancer treatment whereby we put a tube down through the esophagus, and the radiation is passed through that tube and just burns that area that has shown cancerous cells.
So for you, when it came back, that must have been, now you're thinking, no treatment, then again I have to go through the same treatment. Because treatment in itself, it's not easy. It's very intensive, right? Yeah?
Yes.
So you were worried?
No.
Even the second time when it came back, you were just confident?
When third time or fifth time, I could not get worried because I believe, and I normally tell the doctor, that my belief is in a field of a game, the referee is final, and those who are playing are not final. So the doctor is the referee, and I'm the person playing. So with me, I have to believe on what the referee says and who is the doctor.
Yeah.
So with me, I'm convinced, totally no worried, nothing.
Is any of the treatment painful, or is it all easy?
With the surgery, we cannot do it. It's painful,
yeah,
not?
Yeah, because you're under, yeah.
The one which I felt is painful, kidogo, it was the implant
therapy.
Yeah, and it was not the doctor's fault, it was my fault. Because I was told to relax. And it did not relax, and it did not move fast time because it was done twice. So that one, and to force that tube through the esophagus, then I felt some little pain. But the second day, I relaxed, and then things were normal. So there was no match to worry of.
Dr. Kirimi, in cases where you see that the cancer coming back, why is it? Is it that, because if it has completely been removed, then one would imagine it's gone. When it comes back, how do you explain that to a patient?
There are very many reasons why it could come back. As Dr. Nyongesa said, the surgery had been done and it appeared that it had been totally removed. But again, you know, cancer cells are microscopic. And
meaning they're very tiny?
They're very small. You know, when it becomes a growth, a big thing that can be seen, that's when it actually causes the symptoms. Now, these cancer cells may pass through the blood and go to the bones. They could go to the liver. So at the point of surgery, you may not be very sure if all you're seeing, just that mass in the esophagus, is all there is. We don't know whether a few of the cells have moved into the blood and gone to the liver. And after a while is when we realize, oh, now there's something else growing in the liver from the initial, the growth in the esophagus. And then different types of cancers behave differently. There are those cancers that are indolent. By that I mean they're not aggressive. They don't spread. They don't recur. But there are those that are notorious, that even in their earliest stage, they've already spread to quite a number of organs.
Okay. So the most challenging part, would you say then, of this cancer, what is it exactly? Because the catching of it sometimes could be tricky in terms of, as we heard even from that feature, that it's very hard sometimes to tell that it's there. But also in treatment, would you say the fact that it can recur, or what would you say is the most challenging aspect to the esophagus cancer?
Yeah, one is that these cancers tend to hide, or people just ignore the symptoms. Even just simple weight loss, you know, you find you are losing weight. And as Peterson said, people try to say, okay, this food is, I think it's too thick, so they keep downgrading. And you know, sometimes people come when they are not even able to swallow saliva at all. So that time the cancer is quite advanced. Okay. So that is one of the biggest challenge that I get, that patients actually come late and the chances of cure are reduced.
All right.
Yeah. And then the fact that you'll treat, and this cancer, because it's microscopic, the surgeon can remove and some cells remain very close to the original tumor bed. And after some time you've treated, they are resistant. They just start swelling again and growing up.
So it can be cured, cancer of the esophagus?
If it's diagnosed early, it can be cured. The only challenge in our setup is that people are coming late because of the ignoring of the gut feeling, you know.
Yeah, this is something I can handle.
Yeah.
So for you, Peterson, from the time you first, you know, with this swallowing of food problem, went to the doctor, up until now, how long has that been?
There's no pain.
No, how long has it been? The period of time?
3 years.
3 years.
3 years.
So the first treatment to the cancer coming back, how long did it take before it came back?
It took 2.5 years.
2.5 years.
Yeah.
Are you concerned now that it could come back?
You see, my belief is that things are okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I believe that I'm okay, I'm cured. Until I'm told by the doctors that I'm not okay.
Okay.
Through their clinics that I'm told to attend.
So
but
do you still
my
go
body,
for clinic?
With me, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. My body feels okay, comfortable. And I'm swearing well, I'm eating everything that I'm told to eat. I'm told to eat everything. Now, there's no food, specific food I have to eat. And that's why I feel I'm okay.
So do you still go for checkups?
Yes.
How often?
Like now I'm going in December 10th. That's after 1 month.
So every month you go for a checkup?
Yeah.
And in this period, perhaps to just come back to you, what are you checking for? Are you still monitoring, see if it's come back every month?
I mean, Peterson has done tremendously well, 3 years for esophagus cancer. We thank God, and he's a strong person. So when they come to us, we really do clinical evaluation, mm-hmm. and it's the patient to direct us depending on the symptoms. We do imaging, not necessarily every month. If the patient has no major complaints, we don't do tests every month, but we do clinical evaluation, and maybe after 3 to 6 months, we do an X-ray, like a barium swallow. We can also do a CT scan to check the commonest places this cancer can spread to.
So you say he's lucky because it kills. It's a killer disease. It's one among the top 10 killers.
I mean, in men is number 2, in women is number 3.
Why in men is it higher in terms of killing?
I think it's the lifestyle in terms of alcohol and tobacco use. Mm-hmm. Our men smoke more than the women. And in women, really, it's the cervix and breast which take lead. And that's, you hear stories about cervix and breast and hardly about esophagus.
Okay.
But it's coming third.
So, Dr. Kirimi, to viewers who are watching right now, what is it that they need to know that's most important? Maybe some that missed the feature that ran earlier in terms of catching this, because what we're hearing from Dr. Nyongesa is that the challenge she sees most is that they come in late, these patients. So what is it that must be looked at very carefully by everybody?
Okay, I must agree with Dr. Nyongesa. Unfortunately, unlike other cancers, like the cervix or the breast that is an external organ, so if there's a swelling, you could actually feel it, or the cervix where we have screening tests like pap smears. Unfortunately, for cancer of the esophagus, there isn't one test we can do to screen, to keep screening even before symptoms show up, you know, like the way we keep doing pap smears and mammograms. So it is more of people recognizing the symptoms early.
And these are?
This would be fast, persistent, continuous heartburn. 2, regurgitation, you know, this feeling like food is coming back up. 3, difficulty in swallowing that is progressive. Initially, it is just solid food, feeling like food is stuck in the throat. 3, unexplained weight loss. You're not dieting, it's not that you're doing any extra exercise, but you're actually wasting. It's more of like body wasting. Mm-hmm. It's not even losing weight. Mm-hmm. It's just unexplained, drastic weight loss. As I had said earlier, vomiting out fresh blood.
Yeah.
Okay. Or passing out stool that is dark colored because of probably swallowing blood from the tumor and it undergoing all the digestive processes.
All right.
The other thing would probably be to educate people about the risk factors. Some of the things that can actually be prevented to reduce, you know, there's no one known cause of cancer of the esophagus, but there are risk factors. One of them has already been alluded to, tobacco,
smoking.
Whether you're smoking cigarettes, cigars, or chewing it, alcohol.
Shisha,
which is a form of just flavored tobacco, so any tobacco product. Alcohol, another risk factor would be obesity, because with obesity, we find most obese people will tend to have the problem of regurgitation, you know, the contents of the stomach keeping on coming up, and the contents of the stomach usually have acid. So that constant irritation of the esophagus is a risk factor. The other thing is, we know people who've had cancers of, for example, the breast or anywhere else of the head and neck, who've undergone radiotherapy, mm-hmm. may also be at a higher risk of developing these cancers.
All right.
And if you've ever had a family member who has had cancer of the esophagus, then would advise you to keep going for checkups, because it also does run in families.
In families. Our time is up, but quickly from you, Peterson, this must have cost you a lot, has it?
Yeah.
Dented your pocket, because this is a lot of treatment I'm hearing, and that you still constantly have to go for this screening. It's an expensive affair, would you say that?
Yes.
Okay. What do you tell a person who has perhaps been treated, they've survived, in terms of if it may come back or how they need to now live their lives?
I would advise that one should not fear and to be courageous, mm-hmm. and should believe that life should continue, because doctors are blessed to treatment, to high standards of treatment. And of course, as a layman, we say doctors are second to God. So we don't believe that one will cure, then life will be there.
Okay.
Continue.
And doctor, you say that lifestyle must always be checked on to ensure that you're eating and living a right life in terms of even some of the risk factors she mentioned, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll end it there. Thank you all for joining us. John Peterson, extreme left there, who's a survivor of throat cancer, and we wish you the best and you have a great attitude. So all the best with more of your, not more treatment. We hope it will not return. Dr. Mudoni Kirimu is a pathologist and Dr. Catherine Nyongesa, an oncologist, for being with us this morning. Director, I don't know if you'll allow me to read a few messages. We had asked people to send in success messages for the candidates who begin their exams today. Kenya Certificate of Secondary Education, over 400,000 candidates sitting for the same. And I have a few messages here that I want to sample. We have Gitonga, who is saying that the best thing is that you have been reading. That's an assumption, maybe some have not, but we wish you the very best. Rafael Ikoha says, all sitting candidates, simply want to say best wishes to you. Kelly Boss, you're saying it is all about the hard work that they've put in for the last 4 years. Great focus and no cheating. We'll see them have success. Walter Okello, I wish all Form 4s of Rarieda constituency the very best in the exams. You've had the best preparations. God bless you. Mind Shift says, do your very best. And when the results come out, keep in mind that they don't define who you are. So they're him looking at the bigger picture, saying that that is not the end of the road. It is indeed not the end of the road. On behalf of everyone that made the show possible today, thank you so much for watching. I'm Sophia Wanuna. Have a lovely Tuesday. We'll see you tomorrow, bright and early.
Welcome home.